Alaska Insight is supported in part by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by viewers just like you. Thank you.
Alaskans will choose a candidate to fill Alaska's lone seat in the U.S. House on November 6th. Political newcomer, independent Alyse Galvin, is challenging decades-long incumbent Don Young. Galvin is our guest this evening on Alaska Insight. Good evening. Tonight on Alaska Insight, Alyse Galvin, an independent candidate running for U.S. House, will describe why she wants to be Alaska's first congresswoman. Galvin is a newcomer to running for office, and Alaska Public Media's Nat Herz brings us this story about her life as an Alaskan.
If you take a look around Alyse Galvin's home in Midtown Anchorage, it feels cozy and comfortable, almost like it could be the house that Galvin grew up in. Her family has a long history in Alaska.
This is actually my grandpa at First National Bank. It was the first drive-through bank in Alaska. Started as a cashier and worked his way up to VP.
Galvin's childhood was far from settled, though. She says her mother suffered from mental health problems, and Galvin spent time with relatives out of state, going to school. She'd come back for summers. At college in San Diego, she was playing floor hockey when she met the man who's now her husband, Pat. Alyse says they were methodical in searching for a city to settle down in, but she engaged in a little subterfuge when it was time to find Pat a job.
Then when it came time to send out resumes to different possible law firms or even financial firms, I offered to send out the resumes, and they by chance got sent mostly to Alaska. And so, in fact, entirely to Alaska. And he did get a few nibbles.
Pat worked as an attorney and ultimately took a job in state government, becoming commissioner of revenue under Sarah Palin. He now works at a small oil company, Great Bear Petroleum. Alyse has a degree in political science. She's run a company that sold publishing supplies, been a manager at the Anchorage Sheraton, and worked in the State Department of Education. When Pat was working in Juneau, Alyse also took responsibility for her four kids. Cooper is the oldest. When Galvin does have time to relax, she likes to play bridge. Her kids play too.
The cool thing about cards is not only do you learn things like manners and have a chance to get together with multi-generations, but you also are learning algebra without even knowing you're learning algebra.
Galvin hasn't exactly had a ton of time for hobbies on the campaign trail, but she's still been able to play a couple of times with her 96-year-old great uncle.
Alyse Galvin, independent candidate for U.S. House, joins me now. Hello.
Hi.
And I wanted to let listeners, viewers know that we reached out to incumbent Don Young's campaign. They did not schedule Mr. Young for an appearance on Alaska Insight. Mr. Young will be here for debate for the state on Friday, October 26th at 7 p.m., as will Ms. Galvin, and that will go out statewide on radio and television. So, Ms. Galvin, thank you so much for being here. You're running for U.S. House. For people who aren't familiar with you, this is your first time running for office. Give us a little background and
sure.
What prompted your decision to decide to jump in the race.
Absolutely. So I'm a lifelong Alaskan. My family came up in World War II, and they became every sort of, from a builder to a butcher to bankers, auto mechanic. That's my dad, and I ended up going south for schooling, and I met my husband there, came right back up here to live our life and have our four children here. I have in my work experience done everything from working in construction to working waiting tables. I was a waitress at many restaurants here in town even, and I've also owned two small businesses. I've also been a manager of a large hotel, and it was in my work with advocating for public education that brings me here today. I spent the last 4.5 years with a group called Great Alaska Schools. And we were 40 parents, grandparents. We were community members, educators, grew into a group of more than 4,000. And I helped lead a real movement that would bring people together in a nonpartisan way to ensure that we put public education on the front burner so that there's more accountability, more predictability, and certainly more respect for the importance of every child to have a quality public education. And in that work, it became clear to me that until we change things up so that we can see more bipartisan work, people dropping the partisan battles to really get stuff done, we're not going to make any changes. We need bold, tenacious leadership. And so I decided to join a group called Alaska Women Ascend, wherein I was going to help others become elected. That was my goal. And a few months in, it became clear, after learning about what it takes to be a candidate, what it takes to serve, that it's my time. And of course, we know that I have never run for office, and I'm not a career politician like...
And that would be a follow-up question that I would have is why did you decide to shoot for the U.S. House rather than starting with local or state level a run for office? Why this race?
Well, this is the race that has the most need. We have so been missing leadership here. And I think that it's time for us to have people in Congress who are more attached to everyday life. People who are everyday people like myself, who's been there in many workplaces, who's raised children recently. Someone who gets it, that we cannot at all live with our system right now of healthcare. Because I've been experiencing it, I've watched my elders experience it. So our workplace needs to be with more opportunity. Our healthcare needs to get turned on its ear. Our public safety right now is very much in a place where we need to have more attention. And so looking at all of these pieces together and what's going to make Alaska stronger and make sure that my kids want to have their kids here is going to take someone in Congress who's not there to get reelected, who's there to get something done and work together. So I'm excited for this opportunity. And, you know, remember it's called of the people, by the people, for the people. That's what Congress is about. And so I'm ready to serve.
Where have you been in the state campaigning? Mm. And what have you heard from Alaskans?
So I have been in as many places as I can be. I'll try to name as many as I can remember. It's been quite a few months of travel. I've been in Kotzebue. I've been in Bethel a couple of times, up river to Kwithlik, Napaskiak. I've been to Kotzebue. I've already mentioned that, Cordova. I've been to Kodiak. I've been to all around the southeast, Ketchikan, Sitka, Juneau many times, Fairbanks many times. Many of the places in between, the Mat-Su Valley, of course, and Kenai, so Homer, Sedotna, Seward, Moose Pass, you name it, I've stopped in and had a conversation with people.
And what are you hearing? What do Alaskans
say? What Alaskans are saying is, number one, they're so grateful that I'm there, I'm present, I'm listening to all Alaskans. We have public events everywhere I go, so it's not a... You know, I'm opening my door just for Republicans or just for Democrats. It's for everyone. You know, 56% of our state is independents like me. So it's important that we have these conversations together. And they're saying things like, number one, they're worried. People are very anxious about their health care. People are anxious, people, elders especially, those who are on Social Security and Medicare, they see those threatened. And they're living within their means as much as they can, but they have supplemental insurance to their Medicare and even pharmaceutical insurance, but they can't afford their pharmaceuticals. That's the number one, is healthcare. And it's been all sorts of stories around healthcare, but that's the biggie. Public safety is another one, everywhere, rural and urban. And a lot of it is to do with the opioid epidemic. I'm sure they do mention that. No, it's not like we're feeling like they're going to hurt us. It's that they're always robbing. So there's a lot of uncertainty around that. And there's a lot of uncertainty even around education. And you know that's an area that I pay a lot of attention to. Well, we're not really thinking about cradle to career, getting ourselves really ready with employability skills right now. So I think we have a ways to go to help our state feel more hope about how we're going to get to these places. And we have all sorts of ideas in terms of how we're going to diversify our economy to make sure that we have those meaningful jobs. But we need a champion, someone who's willing to look toward the future.
You mentioned earlier this week on Talk of Alaska mm-hmm. that your first priority, and you've been talking a little about that just now, that healthcare would be your first priority mm-hmm. in Washington if yeah. you're elected. Talk about what you think can be done in that area, and what, in your mind, is the best overall plan? Should mm-hmm. should there be universal health care, mm-hmm. single-payer system? Mm-hmm. What do you want to see happen?
Yeah, so you're right. I have been hearing about it a lot, and that's why it is my top priority, because I think it's what the people are looking for a fix. That's the area primarily first. That's getting in the way of any business growth, small business, large business, even the public sector jobs. That's taking up the biggest piece of the whole economy. And so what I'm seeing is that there are some fires that we can put out right now in the area of pharmaceuticals, which we just talked about. We know that if we were to be able to purchase drugs across the border in Canada or safely in Europe where it's safe, we could save a lot of money. We have not opened up the marketplace to allow us to do that. Similarly, nobody stood up to Big Pharma at all. We know that even our president has said, yeah, I would like to lower our drug costs, but it has not happened one bit. We have elders in this state right now who are rationing their drugs because it's so expensive. And yet we know we have such a big buy with so many on Medicaid and Medicare that we can bargain for lower costs. We just haven't stood up. And some of that, I believe, is because we've been so much in the pocket of big pharmaceutical corporations that we haven't had that political will, that strength. And I'm not taking a dime from any corporate PAC money to get elected. So I'll be in a unique situation. And frankly, I think every legislator should be there so that they can really make decisions for the people.
You mentioned on Talk of Alaska earlier mm-hmm. this week that you like the NUCA model mm-hmm. of care that the South Central Foundation has for Alaska Native yeah. participants in healthcare. Talk a little bit about why that particular program mm-hmm. is appealing to you.
Because it's working. It's efficient and it's effective. So it's efficient in that it's lower cost. It's about half the cost as you and me if you're on private insurance. And it's effective in that the wellness outcomes are higher than ours. And that needs to be thought about. We know that there's a much higher percentage of the healthcare dollar going into care with their system. In fact, it's anyone who is on Medicare, Medicaid, or any of those systems, in Indian health dollars too, it's 3 to 8% of the dollar is going to administration. Whereas in private insurance, 25 to 35 cents on the dollar is going into administration. In other words, not into our care. And I think it's important that we think about that as policymakers and make sure that we come to a place where every Alaskan and every American has quality, accessible, and affordable health care, and in a plan that's comprehensive. And I'm not going to say that there's this answer or that answer. I'm open to whatever it takes, but we've got a model here that works, that's serving more than 100,000 Alaskans. I think we should be smart and carry that to Washington and put it on the table, at least allow us to buy into that. So there's a way for us to get there. We see it already working. We just need to have leaders in place who are not in anybody's pocket.
Let's talk about jobs and economic development a little bit. Mm-hmm. You have stated that you'd like to see construction of deep water large vessel ports. What do you think that should look like, especially in the Arctic, where yeah. right now there isn't much for search and rescue, mm-hmm. There's not much Coast Guard presence. What do you think the Arctic part of the coastal plan that you would yeah. lay out should look like?
So we do have the longest coastline in the whole nation that it really isn't getting the proper connections or resources. Our primary Coast Guard port is in Kodiak. We have some in Juneau and in Ketchikan, a few other places, but those large vessel ports do not exist in the northern area. And so we are really without an opportunity to have them come in and train there or get more supplies, et cetera. And it's really important to us as a state and as a nation to have that possibility. Yes, that will bring jobs because it will also bring an opportunity to build the infrastructure. It also will lower our costs, a transportation of costs of goods, which is important to many of the areas. So Kotzebue, Nome, there are many areas that are ready for a port, and we need to start talking about that and getting the resources there. There's more than that, though, with economic development that we really need to get our heads wrapped around. It's around building infrastructure that's Wi-Fi or internet, broadband. That will hugely open opportunities for us. And remember, we're thinking about in the 21st century jobs. These are internationally marketable skills. Once we have our youth ready to design software, there's no reason that Bethel doesn't have a great opportunity for designing the next iPhone app or even software game, whatever it is. We could be doing that if we had access to the tool of broadband throughout our state, which we don't have. And that will grow more opportunities for our youth to stay in their communities and still have jobs and thrive. Remember, we want to thrive, not just survive. And lastly, I just want to make a point about taking the opportunity where we see climate change first, ground zero here in Alaska. That is also an opportunity for job growth, and I can't wait to be a part of that.
Vocational and technical schools, you were mm-hmm. just talking about education. Mm-hmm. We've seen the closure of some programs because of state budget cuts, some of the offices, satellite programs. What would you propose on the federal side mm-hmm. that could help boost programs to put people to work outside of a four-year degree?
Right. It's true in many of our, in the statewide, we have 70% of our children or young adults not going on to a four-year college, 70%. And so we need to make sure that we have these a career opportunity for these youth. And yes, we have some regional centers. Some of them received dollars on the federal front, and we need to make sure that funding stream continues and is built up, especially given the fact that we know we need to be ready to build differently. We need to be ready to be building the homes in a place where we're experiencing climate change first. And we already have some great prototypes out of UAF, where they have the most research and development around climate change. They also have model homes where they're using locally resourced energy, and we need to get ourselves ready, retrained for those sorts of jobs. And that's something that using these, what you mentioned, vocational training centers, they're ready. We just need to resource them, make sure that they're getting what they need in order to be ready for those jobs of building homes differently in order to make us able to stay in our communities, in rural Alaska especially, and afford staying there because the energy costs are affordable once we're using local energy that is renewable. And we've got some great opportunities for that. Yes, we need to maintain the good jobs we have now in natural resources. We're a natural resource state. And 2/3 of our economy is based on that. And as we are diversifying, we're actually growing more opportunities for the youth that you're talking about, who need to have a way forward, and I can't wait to be a part of that.
Let's talk about the resources that mm-hmm. the state depends heavily on, oil and gas. Mm-hmm. I want to make sure that I have this correct. You stated that you support development of ANWR, but not offshore. Is that accurate?
Mm-hmm. So I do support, if we are using our regulations now, I support if we can safely and responsibly drill in ANWR, I support that. I do support that we also follow the important regulations and permitting system that we have in place, because Their drilling will happen only when we can prove up that it's safe and responsible. Offshore, I believe that we do not have what it takes to ensure right now with our current technology that we can drill responsibly and safely. I'm not sold yet. I have seen what happened off of Louisiana, and I'm concerned about offshore drilling. I'm concerned, and I feel like we need to have a little more information about that, particularly in the Arctic, where we know on broken ice, we don't have what it takes to clean up the ocean. We just don't. We have, I think, 1.5 cutters, whereas Russia, for example, has 21. Well, that's another area where we need to have federal resources to grow our opportunity to make sure that our ocean waters are safe and clean. Right now, I'm concerned about that. So that's where I stand with that.
The another area of resource development mm-hmm. is mining mm-hmm. in Alaska. What yep. do you think the future of mining should look like? A lot of the laws are old mm-hmm. as it relates to mining. What should Congress's role be in updating those laws and overseeing regulations? How much of that do you think should be on the federal side, and how much should be up to the states?
So we have state laws in place that are very old. They're archaic. And I think that we need to ensure that we are growing, building a new set of laws that reflect the way we are doing business now. And I also think that would not be in my purview as your congresswoman. I would, though, be able to ensure that those who are in place on the national level use really what makes sense. That would be science-based research decision-making. So that's what I firmly believe that we need to grow, and there are some ways we can change up some of our regs. I think that we need to look at what we can bring in a systemic way to allow for more input by scientists and for local people in Alaska to have input. So I look to bring back things like Alaska Coastal Management Program, which had an efficient and effective way of allowing for that input. And I don't think we would be in a lot of the mess we're in today if we had had that in place, to be honest. So that's what I look to do systemically. In anywhere in the nation, but particularly Alaska, where it's a unique problem for us.
In just a few seconds, we have mm-hmm. much less than a minute left. You have written that you want to put partisan politics aside to find solutions. How do you think you can do that in such hyper-partisan times?
Well, that's just who I am. With Great Alaska Schools, we had people over here and over here, and we worked together focusing on a common goal. And I think that is exactly what we need to do. Being independent, it's very clear to everyone, this is what I believe in, and so that they will see that as an example, because I've run through the Democratic primary, but I am independent. I've seen our whole government shut down over the last couple of years because they hadn't had that sort of thinking, and it's time for us to get there.
We're going to have to leave it there. Thank
okay.
you so much, Alyse Galvin, independent candidate for U.S. House. Thank you so much for joining
you
us
bet.
For Alaska
Thank
Insight.
You.
Independent Alyse Galvin is running for Alaska's lone U.S. House seat. The long-term incumbent, Don Young, will debate Ms. Galvin live on Debate for the State on Friday, October 26th at 7 p.m. We hope you'll tune in for that program, and remember to vote on November 6th. Each week on Alaska Insight, Alaska Public Media goes into the community to go beyond the headlines and provide perspective on the issues that have Alaskans talking. You can watch past episodes of Alaska Insight online at alaskapublic.org/alaskainsight or stream them on AK Passport. You can also engage with us on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Your comments will help us determine future topics of discussion. We return next Friday at 7:30 p.m., right after Washington Week. In the meantime, stay informed and connected by listening to your locally owned and operated public radio station. Thanks for joining Alaska Public Media for this edition of Alaska Insight. I'm Lori Townsend. Good night.